With God, there is always more. More love, more life, more freedom. Welcome to Zoe's Exploring More with Michael Thompson. C.S. Lewis once wrote, "Our Heavenly Father has provided many delightful ends for us along our journey, but He takes great care to see that we do not mistake any of them for home." Join me and the team as we explore the kingdom together, discovering the deep truths and offering encouragement for the journey. There is always more. Welcome to the Exploring More podcast, hanging out with SJ and Gary Barkalow and Jim Chenet, part three of a three-part series on the elder sage stage. There's some masculine journey components to a new book I've been working on for a few years and wanted to have this conversation with my friends, with brothers, with two men that are in this stage, stepping into this stage, and felt like as we've explored already in session one and two, I don't even want to go through a review, SJ, because I know we're a little tight on time today.
No, so just go back and listen.
Go back and listen to those.
Yep.
At the end of the second episode, you know, we started to turn into this idea of what do the good ones look like? What do the good ones do? What is it to walk in your glory in this stage?
Yeah. What's a good sage look like?
Yeah. Yeah. So Gary, you did it last episode, but could you just recap a little bit? And then I want to talk about particularly aspects of this. What does it look like to walk in your glory in the splendor of how you bear God's image and how you offer that to people? So what can you remind us that'll carry us into this session a little bit?
Yeah, what we talked about at the end was this idea that our calling, our life is about a certain aspect of the glory of God that we carry. Glory meaning the weightiness, the beauty, the splendor, the brilliance of God. And that does not decrease with age. It actually increases. Mm-hmm. There's no magic line where you cross over and now you're decreasing in the glory of your life, as it can be with our physical bodies. That's just not true. It's always increasing. And Paul talks about it's the glory of our life is ever increasing. And so what does change over time, and actually throughout our life, it's very true. God will give us varying assignments where He wants us to take the glory, the weightiness, the brilliance of our life, because it's needed in the place that He sends us as well as for those people. And at the same time, God uses that for our own training and development and strengthening. So when a person often comes to the latter years of their life, their exterior world changes. It may be they leave their job for one reason or another. Their whole parenting things change because maybe their kids are older. They've moved away. So many things have changed. Your assignment is changing. You feel like you just don't have one, but you do. And the thing I ended with is this idea that you may feel like you lost, you know, your freedom, your assignment, but actually you've gained freedom now. So let me share a story. So this was a couple of weeks ago. I was with a group of people and, you know, I said, let's just take a few minutes and let's ask God what He wants to say to each one of us individually about our life right now, you know, about where we should be, what He's up to, why we are in this moment, and what does He put in us that's needed for this moment? I mean, you guys do the same thing. Whenever we speak and invite people to do that, we are doing it ourselves. Mm-hmm. And one of the phrases that came to me was, Gary, you do not work for a ministry. You work for me. So you go where I tell you to go. And that may not seem significant to you, but it was for me. It spoke to my heart of God saying, I've got something for you to offer others, and I know who the others are. Just listen to me and I'll take you there. Mm. You know, don't stay loyal to one thing, stay loyal to me. And that was very freeing. And I believe a sage needs to live that way of where do you want me to bring what you have given me to what people?
Yeah.
Jim, you have a response to that?
That's a great example. It's a great story. You mentioned earlier, I love the metaphor of the staff. The transition goes from you're wielding a sword to you're walking slowly with a staff. You're solving problems to you're building relationships. I say often that I spent most of my life using people to accomplish tasks, and I'm learning now that the opposite is really true. I should be using the tasks to help to grow the people. That whole focus on people instead of being versus doing, right? Mm-hmm. You wanted to be fearless, and now you need to be vulnerable. Come on, Scott. What do you think about that?
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Vulnerability. Right?
Vulnerability. Yeah. That's right. Yeah, Gary and Jim, I think about a good one to me. And SJ, I hope things are coming to your heart and mind too. A good one to me, a good elder sage hands out, he's not a water boy, but he hands out cups of living water. He knows how to do that because he knows where the well is and he's looking to offer. You know, there's people who are going to just ignore it. There's people who may even knock it out of your hand. But a good elder sage is that man who he's looking for who needs some water, who needs some encouragement, who needs some nourishment. And he doesn't want to provide it in a drive-through. He really wants to, there's a table around him somewhere. He wants to set it down and have you sit down and get into some of your story. You know, he's settled. And so he wants to know your story. I think it was the first episode, SJ, you brought up Miyagi, you know. Well, at the end of the tournament, and this is just so classic in the film, at the end of the tournament, you know, Daniel San wins and they're hoisting them up and he's yelling, Mr. Miyagi, and he's just over there in the shadow. He's just over there on the side in this smile, right?
Pleased. Yep.
It's like you said, Jim, maybe he isn't the one in the circle, in the octagon, in the arena, but he's coaching those that are. And when they win, he wins. And he feels that instead of I've got 10 seconds to prove my existence, you know, the chariots of fire, Abrams and the other sprinter, right, is saying that when I run, I feel God's pleasure. Well, these are the coaches, right? And how are you coaching those players? Are you coaching them that you've got 10 seconds to prove your existence? Or, you know, when I used to run, I used to feel God's pleasure. Really? How do you do that? Now you have a student, right? Now you have somebody who's interested and you didn't tell them how to do it. You shared a story about how you learned to do it. I think there's a craftsmanship to this. Jim, you pound the drum on this all the time about asking questions and being a listener and asking questions. I think that's a skill of an elder sage, a good one.
I love, you brought up movies. I love the movie, Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood, where Fred Rogers, there's a wounded man in that story, Larry Vogel, I think is his name. And Fred just gently, quietly pours into Larry's life, helps Larry to redeem his life at the end, to become more of a father, husband, and son at the end. It's a beautiful example of what you're talking about.
Yeah, because he comes in a little antagonistic.
Yeah.
You know, yes, that's what I mean. Yes. And a little dismissive, right? And like you said, Mr. Rogers is just Mr. Rogers. And
there's scenes where they're talking to each other and Vogel will say something and Fred Rogers won't say anything. It'll be quiet for, you know, it seems like a long time, but it's probably 10 seconds or 15 seconds. And then he'll just ask a question, which is just a beautiful skill for a sage.
It is. Yeah.
Yeah. I think that allowing silence to speak is a great trait of a sage, and the power and the weight of either asking a question and then letting the silence fill the room, or if there's a break in the conversation, or if there is just a moment, we really do, Michael, I think in the first episode of this series, you talked about how we're just bombarded with information now and just filled with data all the time. Mm-hmm. And so the idea of 30 seconds of silence, I remember that from that movie, Jim. It impacted me when I watched that movie. I'm going to go back and watch it again.
Yeah, I think so too.
The weight of that silence and just allowing the moment to happen. And you don't have to add anything to it and you don't have to detract anything from it. It's a powerful tool of the sage, the one who walks with the walking stick. This is a briefer episode than we normally would go because we're under some time constraints. I wonder if you would, Jim and Gary, share for just a second. When we talked about the sage knowing where the lower seat is, like you were talking about Miyagi, Michael, being okay with being on the sidelines, being okay with taking the lower seat, not always having to have something to offer. The challenge that occurs to me is it's already a stage, it seems to me, that the temptation would be, as we've discussed, to kind of retreat, to kind of hide, to pull back. I don't have anything to offer anymore. I mean, if I were the enemy, that's what I would be saying to someone in that stage. And so how do you balance taking the lower seat with the temptation that the enemy might bring to say, well, you're in the lower seat because you don't have anything to offer anymore.
We've been using different illustrations for this. And the one that we've often used is this idea of the fourth quarter. I think it's such a good illustration because in the fourth quarter, for instance, of a football game, right, that game is going to be won or lost at that point. And at this point, you have studied the other team. You have played with the other team against them. You understand how they operate, who they are. You understand your team. You understand your weaknesses and your own strength. And it's a time not to hold back anymore. It's win or lose now. There's no holding back. There's no playing it safe.
Yeah.
Or you just call the game at this point. And that's not an option. And, you know, I love the idea that at this point, everybody's got to play according to who they are and their strengths. And so humility says, this is what I'll do. And this is what you need to do because you are really good at this. So you and I can work together in this way. I think that's part of humility, to recognize what someone else is really good at and to be able to admit, this is not my strength. Someone else needs to step forward at this point. I will be their wingman and not their captain at this point. But the thing I also want to bring into this is, you know, this idea that we started with, and that is, it's hard to not hold back. It's hard to offer all that you are if you are still unaware of who that is and you have not dealt with the things that hold you back. You know, one of the questions we ask at the Harvard Warrior and at the Advanced is, when you're trying to figure out what is still in operation in me that I need to deal with, and it really goes in the realm of how do you offer fully who you are and not hold back, the question would be, what is it that is in your heart to do or to offer, but you just can't get yourself to do it? You can't get yourself to say it. You can't get yourself to engage with another person. Ask yourself that question, because that's what is in the way, and then deal with it. Yeah. Or the other question is, what do I keep doing that I wish I wouldn't? Okay, that's in the way. Because a lot of times guys will say, I don't know. I don't know what's going on in my life. I don't know what's holding me back. And sometimes it's a very sincere question and they simply don't know. And you just ask that question, but it's all with the idea of, if you were to fully offer who you are right now in this moment and take the initiative, now not being arrogant and prideful, being humble, but offering, then we have to ask those questions to get that out of the way so we can do it purely, you know?
It's like asking a younger man who's got career issues, if money wasn't an issue, what would you do? Or if you had $1 million, which way would you go? Try to get the things out of the way, the finance issue out of the way.
It's a fun exercise to see what desires, what they would love to do, and what that represents. I know that what you're speaking about is true about humility. It's not the lack of knowing something, especially who I am. It's actually the more you do know, that's the more pure the humility really is.
Unless you don't have to convince others that you know it.
If you don't have to convince, I don't have to offer.
Yeah.
I don't have to tell them. But that dialogue, like you're saying, Gary, I think the elder sage, the good ones have learned that what Paul was saying when he said, pray without ceasing, I think they're in this dialogue with God all the time.
Amen.
I think they're saying, you know, with a smile, should I tell him? No, no, you don't want me to tell him. Oh, I work for you. I get it. You're right. I really want to tell him though. I mean, he's going to drown if I, you know, but if he drowns, you're going to resurrect. But if he asks, can I tell him if he asks? I mean, as we kind of move around this final corner, Jesus was so good at all these things. Even though his age was not what we would call age appropriate for elder sage, we see him doing this. We see him practicing this way. Probably one of the most recent, significant, I mean, brought me to tears for a while, was in The Chosen, when Jesus, in that first season, when Jesus is talking to Nicodemus. He is speaking an elder sage way. He's speaking an elder sage language. Those pauses. To somebody who's in the elder sage stage. So you guys gave some nods on that. Go ahead, add some color, if you will. What is it that makes that, when we think about Jesus and his ability, what a good one does, what a good one's like, and we put that transparency right on Jesus and it works, right? It fits. It elaborates another aspect of his goodness. Go ahead and react to that, and then we can wrap it up.
My favorite scene for sure, on the rooftop when Nicodemus finally has the courage to meet with Jesus, well, in private, in secret. And Jesus's compassion, I think, is what struck me. I agree with you, Michael. I was in tears. Just to see the way that Jesus looked at him, the pauses, the questions, the intense interest in Nicodemus's heart, not his behavior.
Mm-hmm. Even the hard things, Gary, like in that scene, particularly the way they narrated it, he wasn't calling him names. He wasn't doing that. But he was saying some hard things. But how he said them.
Right.
You know, they were kind and provocative.
Yeah, yeah. They did such a great job of showing Jesus with this core of humility, right? Compassion, patience, understanding, of course, grace. And I would just say, the thing about humility, we've brought up some really good things to understand and be trained in how to do, to ask questions, how to listen, what to listen for, how to pause, how to wait. And those are, I think, characteristics of humility. But we need to be careful to say, don't see those as skills and thinking you have humility because you've got the skill now to ask certain questions. Because there is a presence of humility, right? You just feel humility. It's something in the person's eyes, in their countenance. There's something in their voice, their very presence. And that scene, you could just feel it from Jesus, right? It was just humility. He was just waiting. But the other thing about humility is humility always sees and speaks to the heart. Jim, it's what you were saying. Yeah. Always. That's his focus. And doesn't get distracted back to behavior unless it needs to use behavior to bring the person back to their heart. And that was so heart-oriented. It was just brilliantly written and brilliantly acted out.
Yeah. Yeah. So as we close it out, I think that's my hope in every stage. You know, what does Jesus have to say about belovedness and to that part of our heart that is still, no matter how old you are, it is young. And then what does Jesus have to speak to the adventurer, the explorer, that part of our heart that is, you know, pushing beyond the boundaries of safety and into a world that's much more dangerous than we knew? And then what's Jesus saying to the warrior who, no, I've learned the world is harsh. There's an unholy trinity. And like you said, Gary, that I have learned how to fight battles that will serve me into this elder sage stage, especially when, you know, the old Zorro is training the young Zorro, right? When the old sensei is training, you know, the young Daniel's son. When Lionel Logue, who is not a king, but he is the trainer of kings, right? When it comes to having a voice, you have a voice. So I think there's a quote in J.R.R. Tolkien about not all who wander are lost. Well, that's Gandalf, right? He is moving and shows up and he's in different places and different spaces. And when it's time to fight, he's in the fight. But he spends very significant time in the council, in the conversation about where the story is, where the story's going, and what's our role and part to play. Man, that's such valuable wisdom, you know. And even he graduates from the from the gray to the white. There's something validated about him, and he's initiated into a different space for a different assignment in that. So all of that stuff is part of this masculine journey that we're exploring, specifically the elder sage. So I can't wait to craft this, to walk with God more with you guys in the elder sage initiative, the project. What's it look like to invite men to enter into this? Well, I think we're going to be the benefactors of getting to try to walk with God ourselves well, right? That's what the world needs, is more men who are alive in each one of these stages. And this is something that we're going to talk about for a while and wanted to share it with you guys on the Exploring More podcast. So thank you for joining us on this series. There'll be more. I know there's going to be more, but I'm grateful. Thank you, Gary. Thank you, Jim.
Yeah, thanks, guys. Thanks. As always, if you've got questions or comments for us listeners, shoot us an email at exploringmore@zoe.org and leave us a rate and review, if you will, on your podcast platform of choice. Thank you so much, guys. It was really great. And I'm looking forward to more of that.
Yeah. Till next time on the Exploring More podcast.
We hope you have enjoyed this episode of Exploring More. The landing page for this podcast is zoe.org/podcast. That's zowe.org www.wielding.com/podcast, where you can find the show notes and various platforms to which we broadcast. You can also find us and The Life of More by visiting Zoe on YouVersion Bible app, Right Now Media, our Facebook page, and Zoe on Instagram and Twitter. Remember, with God there is always more, and you were made for more.